for your love.
No, 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 no.
You have shown us
situations
that we have dealt with, Lord. Thank you for your love, for showing it to us every single day.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory to your name, God. We give him glory. We give him honor.
Yes, God.
promise to speak to
you.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, God, that your love was reckless enough, Father God, to meet us where we were. Lord, even though we were outside of your presence, you still came looking for us, Father God. You didn't worry about all the others that were surrounding you, but you singled me out.
Yeah, I
got
to move.
Thank you, God. Your love was reckless, God.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Okay.
Thank you, Jesus.
Worship him under an open heaven. Worship him. Honor him. Adore him. Exalt him.
You're worthy, God. Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You've been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You've been so, so kind to me. And oh, the overwhelming, never ending, reckless love of God. Me down.
don't deserve it, still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
How many know he deserves our worship?
Always, yes.
He deserves our praise.
Yes,
he is the only one worthy. Hallelujah, because he paid it all. Hallelujah. Yes. Let's let him know that he deserves our worship.
Right.
Hallelujah. You deserve it, God.
Right.
Hallelujah. Somebody lift your hands and just give him praise. Hallelujah. Oh. Oh.
You deserve it.
Somebody give him worship in this place this morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
Well, we made it. We got it going on. To the glory of God. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you, Lord God, for allowing for us to be here on this wonderful and blessed Sunday morning. We praise you, we thank you, and we honor you. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 You may be seated. You take your chair with you. Go to your car. Have a seat. I'm a sun drinker, so I'm built for this. I may come out into the sun to see how it goes. Amen. Just give me a little bit of I promise I won't be before you long on this wonderful and blessed Sunday morning. I'll just talk loud. So as we move forward on today, once again, we'd like to go through the divine truth Christian Center with God once your dreams and visions realized. This actually isn't my first time actually ministering outside. Many years ago, when we first started, back in the year 2010, there was an incident that happened to where my wife and I, we had a U-Haul truck, and we used to have rehearsal and practice in our lobby, in our actual covering area, if you will. And I'll just give you some preliminaries before our dancer comes forward. Basically what ended up happening was that there was a situation to where we were supposed to be renting out the building on a regular basis, but then we all showed up with all of our speakers and wires and keyboards and the like. It was just my wife and a couple of other members, if you will. And then what ended up happening was that right before we were getting ready to enter into the building, the attendant that opens up the door basically says, I'm sorry, you guys, but another group has rented out this space for this Sunday morning. And I was like, how could that happen? Because I always pay the deposit like 2 weeks ahead of time. And he said, I'm sorry, but there's this other folk group that rented out the building. And he didn't say folk group, but it was like a different type of belief system. Rented out the building because they had more people and paid more money than they booted us to the side. And so, suffice to say, I was perturbed. I was a little bit irritated. We had to make some adjustments because it's kind of hard making adjustments when you are under extenuating circumstances. Nevertheless, I took my little speaker, which actually still exists inside of the church, and it was actually inside of the conference room, that small little one that we listen to for movies. I had one tripod like this one right here. And I put the tripod right to the next of me, took the microphone that came as a combo package with that particular outfit, and I began to ministering to the Word of God. They had a little platform, a little stone platform outside just like this, but there was no covering. It was just the trees that were covering. And I was actually preaching the Word of God as people were walking by right over there in Maitland Park, that park right there. The other interesting part about it is that the people didn't necessarily have a clear view of me because I actually had a tree that was like right there, right in front of me the entire time. So for about 30 minutes or so, I was actually preaching to a tree. We are only 6 or 7 people in our ministry. This came from out of a tumultuous past situation with a prior ministry. There was a lot of chaos that was going on and we couldn't get into the building that morning. Someone say adjustment. Adjustments. All right. Sometimes you have to make adjustments. There's a lot of adjustments that people are having to make right now. Even this morning, the reason why we're outside is because while the order was lifted from the federal level, when it comes to the local level, it doesn't start until Monday. But I still believe that as the people of God, we needed to come together, be with our families, but also adhere with the guidelines, one with another. And so we have our masks. We have our cars, we have our AC, and we have water right there just in case you need it. And then we're going to continue to move forward to the glory of God. So before I start the word this morning, we're going to have our dance ministry come forward and minister to the people this morning. And so I'm just so thankful to God for all of you that are making the adjustments. Also, if you want to go live, this is probably a good time to do it. this is a good time to actually evangelize. We're outside being able to minister as we move forward. So without further ado, if you need a few more moments, I can do that. Okay. All right. So now, the ministry of Sister Winkler. Amen. Put your hands together for the Lord this morning. Amen. 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 Once again, we'd like to welcome you to the Divine Truth Christian Center, where God wants your dreams and visions realized. Amen. This morning's scripture is going to come from out of Revelation chapter 4, verse 1 through 3. Revelation chapter 4, verses 1 through 3. And it says as follows. It says, after this I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I had heard speaking to me like a trumpet said, come up here, and I will show you what must take place after this. At once I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne stood in heaven, with one seated on the throne. And he who sat there had the appearance of jasper and the carnelian. And around the throne was a ring that had the appearance of an emerald. The topic for today, an open heaven. An open heaven. Part of the series, Jesus Take the Wheel, Part 1. The Apostle John, also known as John the Revelator, the theologian, and in some traditions, the divine, was the brother of James the Greater, and possibly one of the younger sons of Zebedee. He was known to come to Jesus at a very early and young age. Some scholars believe he was about 18 years old when he nestled against the bosom of Jesus Christ. He was also, as Jesus said, the one whom he loved deeply. This same John, the John that penned the third chapter, 16th verse, so famous in eloquent words, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth on him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. This same John witnessed the glorified body of Jesus Christ at the Mount of Transfiguration. It was Peter, it was James, John that was there. And then after that, they saw Jesus only. This same John, towards the latter part of his years, after being persecuted, after going through trial and tribulation, was the bishop of seven churches, the same seven churches that you hear in Asia that were spoken about in the book of Revelation. He was exiled during the writing of the opening scripture, age of 90 or so. He was preaching and teaching the gospel. That's the reason for his exile. And as a result of him not bowing to hedonism of Rome, he was sent to the Isle of Patmos, a tiny place nestled in the Greek Isles of the Mediterranean. This man, African theologian Tertullian, writes in his manuscript, said that wrote in his manuscript called The Persecution of the Heretics, describes John's banishment as the result of him not dying or receiving any injuries from being boiled in oil. Not want to worship Diana. Not only that, his vision statement. This particular vision statement that he had about what he saw was so poignant, which was an open heaven. This vision gave us a sneak peek into God's throne room, the place of hope that lies before us, a place we all long to behold after we leave this world, a place that through worship and praise we can experience a sound of heaven touching earth. A sound so great that it stirs the atmosphere for miracles, signs, and wonder. While it may be inconvenient this morning, while there are those that are still feeling captive in their homes right now, even though the order is lifted, even though there may be anxiety and distress, God is still on the throne. While some of us are still late coming to online service this morning, we'd like to welcome you to Divine Truth Christian Center, where God wants your dreams and visions realized. God still has a word for you, and he is still on the throne. First of all, before I get into the message this morning, expeditiously as possible in my T.I. voice, let me see what I did there. I wanted to first of all say that I am so glad to see each and every one of you. I know that everybody is not here as of yet. Some people are still laying in their beds or still cruising through several hundreds of services this morning or just sleeping through it all. Nevertheless, if you're watching this at home, this serves as a time of encouragement to you, an encouraging sign that God is still on the throne And since he is, let's talk about what John saw during the time of isolation and quarantine from the rest of the world. You see what I did there? In Revelation chapter 4, verse 1 through 3, as I repeat in the English Standard Version, it says, "After this I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I had heard speaking to me like a trumpet said, Come up here, and I will show you what must take place after this. At once I was in the spirit, and behold, a throne stood in heaven with one seated on the throne. And he who sat there had the appearance of jasper and carnelian, and around the throne was a rainbow that had the appearance of an emerald. An open heaven, a glimpse of the indescribable, unspeakable God. This was the picture that was displayed before him in a vision while he was a 90-plus-year-old man in exile on the Isle of Patmos. Full of wonder, this God is what we beheld. Full of grace and mercy, this is the God that we see in the open heaven. This God, the one who has never broken a promise or covenant. The scripture says that there is a rainbow that appeared around his throne room, signifying the promise, the same rainbow to some that presented a form of destruction due to the judgment of the world. But to others, it was a description of an ark and a future hope. This particular throne room represents God's order. This is proven in Revelation chapter 4, verses 4 through 8. It says, around the throne room were 24 thrones, and seated on the thrones were 24 elders, clothed in white garments. Not only that, they also had golden crowns on their heads, representing the rewards and representing their authority in the earth realm. And I'll explain to you all in just a moment. From the throne came flashes of lightning and rumblings and peals of thunder. And before the throne were burning seven torches of fire, which are the seven spirits of God. These particular seven spirits represented the archangels of heaven. Some traditions have it that it was Raphael and Michael, as well as Gabriel and Uriel, who are all ministering attendants of God's heavenly army. It was seven of them, but all angels were not named in the scriptures. Verse 6 says, and before the throne there was, as it were, a sea of glass, like crystal, and around the throne, on each side of the throne, are four living creatures, otherworldly creatures, holy creatures, full of eyes in front and behind. The first creature living like or looked like a lion. The second living creature like an ox. The third living creature with the face of a man, and the fourth living creature like an eagle in flight. Let me give you the breakdown of this. When God speaks out of the east, then it's from between the two cherubim with the face of a man. The man represents intellect, or the one of the most intelligent beings, or the most intelligent being on the planet, and he is the king of that realm. When he speaks from the south, then it is from between the two cherubim with the face of a lion. The lion represents courage. When from the west, then it is from between the two cherubim with the face of an ox. This represents strength. It is two oxen that are there yoked together so they could plow the land. It was two oxen that Elijah saw when Elisha was passing through his field, that he saw this particular oxen and he just tossed it to the side and says, must I be able to follow you? And then Elijah said to Elisha, you have asked a hard thing. Nevertheless, come and follow me. And then while Elisha was plowing inside of the fields, he took all of his resources and then tossed it to the side. As he tossed it to the side, he burned all the oxen and all of the plow, all of those things up, basically saying, I am going to follow you until you leave. He was the mentor. It took a lot of courage and strength. Then, when from the north being the place where God, scripturally speaking, has spoken from and where the throne room actually is, then it's from between the two cherubim with the face of an eagle. An eagle represents vision. The man's face represents the kingdom of men and intellect, but yet God is over that, and he's the king over that. The lion represents courage. The lion represents the king of beasts, but yet God is king over that portion of creation. The ox represents strength and power, but God is over that because he is the king of those that have burdens that they could carry. And then finally, the king of all of those in the air, the eagle, represents vision. God has the ability to be able to speak things that be not as though they were. Not only that, Matthew in the Gospels, Mark, as well as Luke and John, represent each face of that same image that was shown in the open heaven. Matthew represented the man, Mark represents the lion, Luke represents the ox, and John represents the eagle. Verse 8 goes on to say, "And the four living creatures, which each of them with six wings are full of eyes all around," talking about a heavenly throne here, "and day and night they never cease to say, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." Before every move of God, there is an open heaven. I hope you can see it this morning. Ezekiel saw this in his vision, the same living creatures, eyes round about, moving in every direction in perfect angles, saying, holy, holy, holy. He saw this vision right as the people were going through a strong period of rebellion. But he served as a sign to them that you could come out of this rebellion and get closer to God. This same particular creatures and group showed up during the time of Isaiah. When Uzziah died, he saw the Lord and he was high lifted up and this train filled the temple. And then out of the shadows came a cherubim with a hot coal. He purged it on his lips and then he was then sanctified and purified. It appeared again during the time of Adam and Eve, but only for a wrong reason, because when Adam and Eve sinned, there was a cherubim that was set at the very foot of the exit of the garden. And at that moment in time, God told those same cherubim, "I want you to take up two swords and I want you to swing them in every single direction." And then finally, Jesus removed it when he entered the Holy of Holies as our high priest of heaven. On the Holy of Holies, as I was listening to some of the psalmists yesterday, as they were taking a class talking about the tabernacle. Well, before you go into the Holy of Holies, as priests, there were these two curtains. Both of them were called the veil. And on those veils were embroidered two cherubim. Both of them had trumpets and both of them had swords, signifying that if you come before God, you can't come before God the same way that you left him. You left him without even taking him into account, like many people left God even before this pandemic even hit. But then as a result of the persecution and the plague that has gone across this land, now people want to come back closer to God, to go beyond the veil, to be in his presence. Many of us were exposed during this particular season. Some of us were exposed for our lack of wisdom. Others were exposed for our lack of faith. Sometimes we believe God as long as we are comfortable. But how many of you know that God is not always about comfort and always about money and always about just appeasing us? Sometimes he wants us to see, or he wants to see if we're going to still serve him, still follow him, even though you may have to make some personal adjustments. People always talk about the early church, and the early church is this, and the early church is that, and we need to go back to the first century church. Well, suffice to say, the early church had no air conditioner. The early church still gave, they still sowed, they still fellowshiped, they still were with one another, and they were up under the hot, beaming sand, even without tents. So we're just giving a small little taste of what it's like to be in the open heaven, still preaching the gospel, still fellowshipping, still representing the church as the glory of God would have it. Once again, before every move of God, there is an open heaven when these creatures will continue to appear over and over again. It was always during a time of rebellion as well as a time of deliverance. So as I conclude, Revelation chapter 4, verse 9 through 11 says this as I close. It says, "And whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who is seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever." That is a sign to us that we need to give him glory and honor and thanks to him who is seated on the throne. If you are alive, if you have food on your table, clothes on your back, and a place to stay, if you have the ability to be able to be out inside of this particular open heaven, and you have a car which has air conditioner, you have a church family that has loved you and has checked on you, then give him honor, thanks, and glory. If you still have a job, and even if you don't have a job, but you have the ability to get a job, you need to give God thanks, honor, and glory. If you still are clothed within your right mind to even make the decision of whether you want to come or not, you can still give glory to God. As you can sense, I get my help. I feel my help coming on because I believe that I'm preaching to a whole bunch of trees. Not only those that are sitting inside of their seats, inside of their cars, or also watching online, but I also see many trees that are around about this particular sanctuary.
Remember, we're still having church. The church is not the building as you saw. The church is convenient. The church has air conditioning. The church has water. The church has seats. The church has all the accoutrements and all the amenities, but that is not the church. We are the church. We are the people of God. We are those that are trying to be a sign and wonder, even as the cars drive by with people that are looking for toilet paper and hand sanitizer or even some type of DVD movie that they can watch at this very hour. We are still being the church. So do not think it's strange that it is not impacting anyone around here. No, it is still impacting people to the glory of God. Give him thanks, honor, and glory. Give him thanks in everything. If you are just feeling discouraged this morning, if you're feeling some kind of way, give thanks to God. It's the antidote to depression. If you're feeling some kind of way and you're feeling a little bit arrogant this morning, like, man, I don't need to be here. There's other places I could be. You need to humble yourself and give glory to God. Anytime you give glory to God, you put yourself in right standing with him because you know your place. And by giving honor to God, you know that God did not have to let it be so clear this morning. He did not let it have to let it be so even so cool this morning. He did not have to allow for it, us to even be able to be outside. So we give honor and thanks to him. The verse goes on to say, the 24 elders fell down before him, who is seated on the throne, and worship him, who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the Lord, saying, worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created. People of God, those 24 elders, as I close, represent a two dispensation. The first dispensation, it represents the 12 tribes of Israel, who all had specific characteristics that indicated that you are a part of the children of Israel, or part of God's people. That was the Old Testament. The Old Testament, they all understood and revered the Ark of the Covenant, of which we have a replica right in our sanctuary. That same 12 was there to govern the people of God, to be a sign and wonder of who God is and how he revealed himself among a people that did not know him. There's a lot of people that still do not know him, even at this very hour. But let us be a sign and wonder, which pivots me to the second 12. The second 12 of those represent the 12 apostles. Each of them was a stone, while Jesus was the chief cornerstone. Each one of those 12 apostles represents the order of God as foundational stones. We now are in the dispensation of the New Testament, where Jesus is our high priest, and now we can go boldly before the throne of grace, no longer have to worry about those cherubim trying to keep us from out of the garden of God. Now we can enter into the garden alone. Now we can enter to the presence of God. Now we can fellowship with him. Now we can disrobe ourselves and be in his presence, be in his favor, be in his glory. This is what an open heaven is like. This is what it's like when we preach the gospel to every living and creeping thing. I had a couple of love bugs that showed up as soon as I started preaching. I said, like, there is love in the air. Don't swallow them until after you leave. Amen, amen. So let us pray. Father, we thank you, we love you, and we honor you. We thank you, Lord God, for allowing for us to be in your presence once again. We thank you, Lord God, for your favor. We thank you, Lord God, for allowing for us to be able to come and fellowship one with another, even under extenuating circumstances. Lord God, I pray, even as we go back to a sense of some level of normalcy, let us continue to be faithful, but also let us be wise. Let us practice social distancing and stay home if we're sick, but if we're not, let us come and continue to glorify God. Lord God, I pray for peace for those that are feeling some type of anxiousness as they are being told to come back to the office. Lord God, I pray for those that are still looking for work. I pray, Lord God, that their finances will be fulfilled. And Father, I pray also for those that are looking for new opportunities, that they seize the moment, seize the time to continue to get closer to you, and not to rest on their laurels, for the world will continue to spin forward. We bless your name, and we honor you, and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, that concludes our morning service. Consider yourselves dismissed. You can fellowship by giving each other an elbow, a high five with your voices only, and be blessed. Be blessed, people of God.